All right. Good morning and welcome back to MorningLine. We are talking about the president's impeachment inquiry. I want to get to the line because I know we have Jean, who's been patiently waiting. Hey, Jean, what's your question?
Yes, I've been trying to wrap my brain around what I'm about to ask. How did we ever find out what President Trump and Putin said when Trump was in Russia and they went behind closed doors and had this conversation? Did we ever find out what they talked about? If we did, then I missed it, and I want to know if that was ever brought up.
All right. Thanks, Gene.
No. The simple answer is that I think we have interpreters' notes, but they've not been publicly disclosed. That was something that was seen as a violation of diplomatic protocol, not to have a note taker outside of the interpreters there. President Trump got into a lot of trouble on that one. That did tend to that aroused some controversy. But he does have this odd admiration for Putin, and this is something. It's ironic in some ways that the issue is the Ukraine, because of course Russia was one of the areas where he really did want to change the policy of the United States and develop a better, closer relationship. And so it's ironic that the issue that he's gotten caught up with is Ukraine, where this is something that is very sensitive to the Russians and something that they did not want the United States to be giving aid to the Ukraine.
Wow. With the president, how has he been reacting through all of this?
Well, he's followed pretty much the same script that he did with the Mueller investigation. It's a witch hunt. It's unauthorized, or it's unnecessary, a waste of time. What is interesting, of course, is that he's also he released the transcript, and again he seems to feel that there was a perfect
nothing
conversation.
Wrong.
There was nothing wrong, and so you really do have this contrast between people who see no, you were pressuring an aide for political reasons. And what Trump is arguing was no quid pro quo and nothing like that. If you watch the Nixon and Clinton impeachments, where there was fights over evidence and what actually happened, in this case it's pretty clear what actually happened. I don't actually find it terribly. It's just a question of what you think, whether that's valid or justified.
What a surreal time to be in right now. After comparing what you just said with Richard Nixon and Clinton, and then all of a sudden this.
And this. I mean, that Trump has tried to stop some of his people from testifying and prevent some aspects of it. But on the whole, they've actually said this is what happened. And it's not, even Adam Schiff, I think, said in the hearings, there's not a lot of contested facts here. Mm-hmm. And so the real question is whether people care enough or think that this is really, it is a violation of diplomatic norms. But that President Trump has been doing that on so many other things that many people might just say, well, that's his style.
That's him.
And in the end, the Republicans do have a valid point in saying that the aid got delivered. Now, that there is a question of whether that it got delivered because there was publicity about this call.
When was that delivered?
It was delivered in September.
Okay.
They changed the policy and then decided to deliver the aid without any quid pro quo or without any guarantee that there'll be these investigations.
I want to talk about something that you wrote recently that was published on the 13th.
Mm-hmm.
That was yesterday.
Yes. Yeah.
You were comparing what was happening with Nixon to what was happening now as far as media attention and the kind of media coverage.
Yes.
It's quite interesting and fascinating, and it's a good way to kind of analyze, even though it's decades ago to now, differences and similarities from the two.
Yeah. Well, what I was writing about was really it was an anniversary, and it was the anniversary of Spiro Agnew's speech. And Spiro Agnew is someone who most Americans probably don't remember him, or would have to think twice about who he was. But if you lived during that time, he became a very famous figure, so much so that the networks all broadcast the speech on November 13th, 1969.
Famous conservative figure.
Well, he was Nixon's vice president. He became a hero to conservatives because he attacked the media, and he basically said the media is biased against our administration, that they questioned the president's sincerity about ending the Vietnam War, and that they were being too favorable to the protesters and anti-war movement, and that got a good response from conservatives and from many people in the country who felt the media did sort of slant in a certain way. The media at the time was only the three networks. This was a very different media environment. There were only the three national television networks. And Agnew attacked them, and this became a major cause. The media insisted that he was trying to censor them, and this turned and it made Agnew a major figure. And Agnew might have been the successor to Richard Nixon had he not been taking bribes during the time he was vice president and ending up having to resign as vice president. So,
an
irony of that. So,
and so, are there any? Is there anything that people now can take away from what was happening then?
I think what you can see is that Agnew put his finger on cultural divides within the United States that have mm-hmm. persisted. His attack on sort of the elite networks, on the anti-war movement, on the protesters were doing. This is a sort of cultural conversation we've continued to have. I mean, President Trump has also attacked anti-war, the attack on pro football mm-hmm. players who kneel, the cultural divides that we've had in this country. So in a way, Agnew was foreshadowing some of the conflicts we've continued to have over the last 50 years.
And back then, were people sharing the same idea that yes, there is this. I didn't know if there were obviously surveys or something back then, but
most people trusted the media. The media actually had a fairly high level of trust. It was where most people got their news. Agnew's attack did resonate with conservatives, but for the most part, there was the sense that the national networks were playing it straight. And of course, during Watergate, they were watched and followed, and that was they played a role, I think, in the fact that Nixon did lose so much support because of the hearings and the way in which they were presented.
And you had Walter Cronkite back then.
You had Walter Cronkite, the most trusted man in America, and all of that, who responded strongly to Agnew. And I think in that sense, the national media was more bipartisan, or seen as more bipartisan, than it is today.
Now, since then, did it start this wave almost of attacking media, or was it just until recently?
Well, if you think about it, Agnew started it, but then he ended up having to resign and was discredited, and I think that tended to lend mm-hmm. a certain taint to the whole attack on the media. And you see that in the 70s, for the most part, the media still had a fairly strong reputation with Americans.
Well, it was also a different style of news already with Vietnam War.
Yes, it was post-Vietnam, this sort of thing, but I think it's not a consistent thing, and I think for the most part, you've had episodes of attacks on media after Agnew, but only in more recent times has it turned into the sustained dislike of the mainstream media and the fact that you now have different medias and people follow different
medias. I mean, you have medias leaning one party
and then leaning
the other, and then you have online and just strictly digital news organizations. So there's just the infiltration of...
The cable television, the explosion of cable television, the explosion of the internet access, so that the media environment in the 1990s and then early 2000s changes so dramatically that you have a very different environment than what Eddie Agnew was talking about.
Right, and I just feel like people are just so passionate that their voices, it's like it's their way of voicing their opinion online, and even online, attack on one is an attack on all, it seems.
It does seem that way. I mean, it has gotten harder to have a single
conversation
or have a single recitation of the facts, even. People see spin in almost everything these days.
Just to almost wrap this up, where do you see the impeachment inquiry going now? I know there is something happening on Friday.
Friday, they'll have the ambassador to the Ukraine speaking, the former ambassador who was fired because of Giuliani's efforts and the rest. And she will probably also be a compelling witness for those who see this as a serious matter. But I see the president ultimately being impeached by the House then not being convicted in the Senate. And then I think the ultimate decision will come in November with the election.
And If he were to get impeached, how fast is that process?
Well, that is a question for the politicians.
We have the election coming up.
Right.
And so
there is this argument that the Republicans might draw it out in the Senate in order to hinder the efforts of many of the senators who are trying to run for president, who would have to stay in Washington rather than campaign during a Senate trial.
Oh, my gosh.
So there's a lot of things going on.
2020 is going to be the year for everyone. Thank you so much for being here. I'm sure when that happens, we'll probably have you on even way before then.
Okay, thank you.
So thanks so much, Professor Thomas Schwartz with Vanderbilt University. Thank you to all the callers today. Great conversation. Have a good day.